Once, there was a great kingdom called Lolan, which disappeared into the sands of the desert. And once there was a great lake which actually moved and traveled in the desert from north to south and back again. The name of the lake was Lop Nor. Both these places, Lop Nor and Lolan, the kingdom that once flourished on its banks, was somewhere near the eastern tip of the Taklamakan Desert in the heart of Asia. No other places on the long Silk Road are as mysterious as these two. It seemed impossible that a lake could really move, or impossible to unveil the mystery of Lolan. To the east, Chang'an. To the west, Persia and Rome. To the south, India. All these places were drawn closer by the Silk Road. The bells of the caravans tinkled, and silk and porcelain traveled westwards, Buddhism and Christianity eastwards. At the very point where the two cultures of the East and West met lay the kingdom of Lolan. The ancient cities of Yangguan and Yumengguan, somewhere near Lolan, are 2,000 kilometers or 1,200 miles west of the modern city of Xi'an. The desert area west of here is used by the Chinese army as a testing ground for atomic and hydrogen bombs, so of course it's top secret. This is an aerial photograph of Lop Nor, shaped like an ear, and of the ancient kingdom of Lolan. But photographs like this, taken from an altitude of 900 kilometers or 500 miles, tell us nothing about the past. We started the search for Lolan from the remote town of Yangguan. A famous Chinese poet once wrote, "What friends can you hope to find once you've left Yangguan?" Our party consisted of 18 people, including soldiers, doctors, and various assistants. We had 9 vehicles, including jeeps, trucks, and water carriers. It was to be the first journey of exploration from Yangguan to Lolan since the Sino-Swedish expedition of 1934, almost half a century ago. The party was led by Captain Da Xingmin of the Chinese Army. He's a topographical expert and a veteran with many years' service behind him. The Silk Road is now submerged by the desert. In fact, it's no longer a proper road at all, just a line on a map. A 100 kilometers or 60 miles from Yangguan, we arrived at the small village of Ho Kong. It's really a small village. In fact, its population was only 2. They were very surprised to see us and gave us a warm welcome, as we were their first visitors for 6 months. They lead a tranquil life, alone in the village, looking after sheep from dawn till dusk. They spin the raw wool into yarn and weave the yarn into cloth. We bought 30 chickens from the two men and 200 eggs, which we packed in buckets of sand. According to the two villagers, this is the best way to keep them from being broken on the journey. We also bought a few sheep as emergency rations. Then we climb back into the trucks and set off once more. Those two were the last people we saw on our way to Lo Lan. There's no doubt that the merchants carrying silk and soldiers on the march with pikes in their hands in those days must have purchased food from the nomads, obtained additional supplies of water, and continued their journey to the west or to the east, just like we're doing now. In his book, Marco Polo wrote, "The desert is so vast that it would take a year or more to cross the whole of it on camelback. Even at the narrowest place, it would take a month. All that's to be seen are mountains and valleys in the sand, and not the smallest sign of anything to eat." This place is called by the Chinese Sword Point Ridge, and it certainly lived up to its name. One of the swords punctured a tire. Suddenly, we saw something moving fast. It was a gazelle. Imagine a gazelle in the middle of the desert. But the soldiers are excellent shots, and the gazelle didn't get far. That day, we pitch camp in the shelter of a sand dune, where we'd be safe from the everlasting northwest wind. It was the third camp since we'd left Yangguan, now about 200 kilometers or 120 miles away. The gazelle we had shot would make a good supper. Everyone set to, under the direction of the army cook, who was elected head chef. Luckily, our new friends turned out to be experts at making spicy Chinese dumplings, just what we needed. In China today, men and women are regarded as equals, so men know how to cook just like women. We had to use a hand-powered generator to make contact with base. We told them our present position and proposed a schedule. We had to do all this because the Silk Road here passes through a secure military area. It was difficult for the soldiers to make sure that their military secrets were properly guarded and at the same time to give every cooperation to the television crew. It was a task that needed the utmost tact on both sides. How many thousands or tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of years pass before all these magnificent formations in the desert achieve the contours they have today? Right in front of us is what is known as the group of eroded rocks. A work of art that nature has created with such painstaking effort. A member of the TV coverage team named this the Sphinx of the Taklamakan Desert. while another member called it the guardian deity of the kingdom of Lolan. It's so elaborate that it could be mistaken for a stupa created by a sculptor. And look at this huge circular mansion that conjures up visions of the dwelling place of a god. When we examined it closely, we saw that the wind had hollowed it out and given it a sharp edge like a fast river with sculpture of boulder. This enormous mesa-like rock measures 80 kilometers by 40 or 50 miles by 25. Our Chinese cameraman called it Da Shanghai, the Great City, because the vertical boulders look like huge buildings with streets between. When the wind began to blow again, we measured it with our anemometer. It was blowing at 25 meters a second, or 56 miles an hour. Now the sand and tiny pebbles were blowing in our faces. It was the start of one of those desert storms the Chinese call flying sand and running stones. Our cameraman was keeping a diary. Here's what he wrote that day. April 10th, 8 p.m. Temperature, minus 2 degrees Celsius, 27 degrees Fahrenheit. Weather, light snow. Since setting out this morning, we've covered 139 kilometers or 90 miles. Men and vehicles have both been pushed to the limit. Ah. 9:30 p.m. We pitched the tent, but the wind got even stronger and it soon collapsed again. It took an hour to secure it the second time. Ah. 10:30 p.m. Still no supper. Eleven thirty p.m. We ate our supper and now we can relax a bit. Preparations for sleep. Everybody's face is white with sand. The layers of earth and sand on our faces give some idea of the climate here. We haven't been able to wash our faces or clean our teeth for several days. It was tough enough for us with all our modern equipment. It must have been much tougher for the early travelers along the Silk Road. Almost 1600 years ago, a Chinese monk called Fa Xian traveled westwards along this same route. He wrote, "In the middle of the desert, when the fiery wind blows, everything seems suddenly dead, as though all life had been obliterated from the face of the earth. No bird is to be seen in the air, no beast on the ground." At the beginning of the 20th century, the explorer Oral Stein undertook an expedition here. He wrote, "We are now about to enter a part of the world where there is no vestige of animal life, and doubtless none has been since the beginning of time. When I passed the shriveled white stump of a lone tree that had fallen on the rock-salt ground, I had the feeling of passing from a country where life still resisted death into a waste where the very notion of life itself had been extinguished." The only thing that could pass through such a place was a road pioneered by nameless men, the bearers of civilization from Chang'an, from Persia, and from Rome. In front of us now is a desert which is called the Mounds of the White Dragon. It's called that because the rock salt projecting through the sand looks like the triangular spikes on the back of a dragon. The Chinese tell an old legend about how these mounds originated. Once there was a great kingdom here, ruled by a wicked tyrant. A god, disguised as a monk, asked for alms. But all the wicked king would give him was a lump of the worthless rock salt that lay everywhere on the ground. The god became angry and caused the waters of Lake Lop Nor to overflow and flood the kingdom, so that it became the home of dragons. The mounds of the White Dragon are as white as fine silk. But to the Chinese, white is the color of mourning. And the travelers along the Silk Road feared the mounds as a world of the dead. Another famous Chinese monk, Xuan Zhang, once wrote, "Many people have lost their way here in this vast plain which stretches as far as the eye can see, but which has no road. Wherever you look, you can see human skeletons marking the way. Because there is no water, nothing can grow here. And when the fiery wind blows, one is immediately plagued by sickness. Sometimes you can hear ghostly voices moaning and crying. But if you follow them, you soon get lost, tricked by the wiles of a demon." The word Taklamakan means the place from which no living thing returns. Yet in one corner of this world of the dead, we found certain proof that the Silk Road once passed through it. These copper coins were minted in the Tang Dynasty about 1,300 years ago. They show that the authority of the Tang emperors must have been recognized here, and that traders must have passed, probably traveling westwards, during the Tang period. Altogether, there were 300 coins, weighing 2 kilograms or 5 pounds in all, lying scattered on the desert floor. We wondered who had left such a lot of money behind. Perhaps it was a soldier on his way home with his saved up pay. Or perhaps it was someone traveling westwards to buy some of those precious heavenly horses which the Chinese wanted for their cavalry. Our position was now 40 degrees 30 minutes north, 90 degrees 30 minutes east, and by now, Lop Nor should be in sight. However, there seemed to be no sign of it, yet on the map, a blue speck marked it plainly. It was surely not possible to miss a lake more than 100 kilometers in diameter or 60 miles. The Swedish explorer Hedin once called Lop Nor the Wandering Lake. Perhaps it had wandered again? We reviewed the strange story of this mysterious lake. The first mention of Lop Nor is in a Chinese history book, the famous Han Chronicles, written more than 2,000 years ago. It says, "The kingdom called Lo Lan lies on the banks of a salt marsh." This is obviously a reference to the salt water of Lop Nor, which was important to the Chinese from early times. Because, as the chronicles explain, the salt marsh is the source of the Yellow River. The lake was explored by the Russian scientist Przewalski in 1877. He wrote, "The latitude of the lake is 1 degree further south than is given in Chinese history books. A distance of about 100 kilometers or 60 miles. The lakes called Hara Brun and Hara Kushum together make up Lop Nor." Richthofen, the man who coined the term Seidenstrasse or Silk Road, disagreed. Lop Nor, he wrote, is situated to the north, as stated in Chinese history books. The lake was in Central Asia, but it was the cause of furious wrangling in far-off Europe, where the opinions of various geographical societies were sharply divided. The man who solved the mystery was the Swedish explorer, Dr. Sven Hedin. On his first expedition, Hedin found a dried-up riverbed in the lower reaches of the Darim River, the dry lake bed of what had been Lop Nor, and the ruins of Lo Lan. He also located lakes Hara Brun and Hara Kushun, which were indeed further south. He concluded that because of a change in the course of the river Darim, Lop Nor had actually shifted over the ages from north to south. Hedin wrote, "With the increasing sediment deposited by the river, the floor of the lake gradually rose, while the deserts, worn down by the erosion of the wind, gradually sank. In consequence, the water of the lake converged towards the lower level, thus accounting for the shift from north to south." In the year 1900, he predicted that Lop Nor would soon start to move north again. About 34 years later, Hedin went on a second expedition to Lop Nor. Traveling down the Kongchu River, a tributary of the river Darim, he found that the water now flowed into Lop Nor, which was being re-established north in its old position. His prediction had been brilliantly fulfilled. He wrote triumphantly, "I am now paddling in a canoe over places once trodden by camels." In 1934, the lake was in a northerly position. In 1900, it had been in a southerly position. And around 330 AD, it had been in a northerly position. Haydin concluded that Lop Nor travels all the way from north to south and back again in a cycle that takes 1,600 years. And that was the end of the controversy. But we were now at 40 degrees 30 minutes north, 90 degrees 30 minutes east. According to Haydin's theory, we ought to be able to see a lake brimming with salt water. But there was no mistake. Scratching the surface of the desert, we found rock salt. Undoubtedly, we had dug into the bed of what the chronicles called a salt marsh, and which was later called Lop Nor. But the lake itself was nowhere to be seen. According to the map, made from satellite pictures, there was now a dam on the upper reaches of the Darim River. Perhaps this is the reason water no longer flowed into the lake. We had a helicopter supplied by the Chinese army, and we used it to search along the Darim River and the upper reaches of the Kongchu. After a journey of 300 kilometers or 190 miles, we could see the Kongchu River flowing peacefully below us. The source of the Kongchu is the melting snow in the far-off Tian Shan Mountains. Most of this melted snow flows eastwards through the Taklamakan Desert. And among the tributaries of the Darim River, the largest amount of water is borne by the Kongchu towards Lop Nor. But although it was still 100 kilometers or 60 miles from Lop Nor, the river had turned into a mere trickle. And before they could arrive at the lake, both rivers had completely dried up. Perhaps the snowdrifts and glaciers on the Tian Shan and Kunlun ranges are no longer big enough to feed the lake. We also looked as far as 1 degree south of our route, and still there was no sign of water. Lop Nor had disappeared again. True to form, the lake is still a mystery. Days after leaving Yangguan, we had our first glimpse of the ruins of Lo Lan, the ancient kingdom that had once flourished on the banks of the salt marsh. After exploring the Kongchi River, one team landed in Lolan by helicopter. They were met by the other party, which had already arrived. Since it lay at the eastern tip of the Taklamakan Desert, Lolan was in its day an important stopping place on the Silk Road. Because of this and because of its great prosperity, it was a constant scene of battle between the Chinese and the Huns. This building, which is made of sun-dried bricks, seems to have been the headquarters of the Chinese imperial garrison. It was said at the time that whoever controlled Lolan controlled the whole of the Silk Road. More than 2,000 years ago, a corps d'élite of 700 men sent by the Han Emperor Wu Di succeeded in expelling the Huns. In those days, many of the Chinese soldiers stationed in Lolan were living very far from their wives and children, for this was a remote frontier. It was more than 1,000 kilometers or 600 miles west of Yangguan and Yumenguan, and more than 3,000 kilometers or 2,000 miles west of Chang'an. A famous Chinese poet, Sen Chan, wrote about the loneliness of the soldiers and how they longed for home in China. The soldiers of China looked on Lolan as a country inhabited by bearded and green-eyed people. In other words, foreigners. When they heard the sad sound of the flute played by one of these foreigners, the soldiers of China must have thought of their mothers and wives and longed to be home. There is a letter of that time written by a man called Chao Ji, who was probably a soldier garrisoned in Lolan. This is what he wrote. I am living in a far-off region, and my brothers, sisters, and children are all at home, far away. I'm afraid the children might not be getting enough to eat or clothes to wear. Perhaps Chao Ji, dreaming of his faraway family, once drew water from this well. According to the experts of the Xinjiang Archaeological Institute, these houses, built with the wood of the toklak tree or giant poplar, were the palaces of great aristocrats or of senior officials. After more than 1,000 years, some of the foundations and beams still look good. This Buddhist stupa, or primitive pagoda, was unusually high, for Lo Lan was a great Buddhist stronghold. The historian Fa Xian says there are no less than 4,000 monks here, a quarter of the entire population. The peaceful Buddhist faith must have been a comfort to the people of Lo Lan, situated as they were in a place that was the scene of constant fighting between Chinese and Huns. Oh, Indora, the bestower of the holy rain, please give us more rain. Please make the crops grow. Glory be to the king of Lo Lan. Such a prayer, intoned by priests, must have resounded throughout the castle. Scientists from the Xinjiang Archaeological Institute who came with us worked at identifying the treasures they'd found until late at night. For there are many questions still unanswered. When was Lo Lan first built? When did Buddhism arrive? When did Christianity come? And when did silk first pass through here on its way westwards? They were particularly interested in the inscriptions on strips of wood. In those days, official documents, Buddhist sutras, letters, and even personal records were all written on wood. An archaeologist explains this may be part of a loom. Here's a gold ring that once graced the hand of a Lo Lan lady. This is a glass bead brought from Persia along the Silk Road. A Roman earring made from agate. And a bronze coin from the Kushan dynasty in what today is Pakistan. All these things excavated here make it clear that Lo Lan was a very important place on the Silk Road, an oasis in the desert where the cultures of East and West were mingled. About 70 kilometers or 40 miles north of the middle of Lo Lan, we found a strange ruin on the top of a small hill, one that apparently had not been visited either by Haydin or by Oral Stein. Posts made of toklak wood had been driven into the ground, outlining elliptical areas. Altogether, there were seven of these elliptical wooden shapes. The archaeologists began to excavate them carefully. Their shape suggested that they had been designed to protect something inside, perhaps from floods. One of the scientists thought they might be the tombs of important people, lords or princes perhaps. The posts were more than 20 centimeters or 8 inches in diameter and had been driven 4 meters or 12 feet into the ground. We all watched, fascinated to see a grave opened after 2,000 years. We were looking at what remains of a man who lived long ago in a far-off land. He had had excellent teeth and a well-developed physique with long legs. He was probably of a northwestern Indian race, like many of Lowland's ruling class. Perhaps he was even one of Lowland's kings. This tiny coffin looked small enough to have contained the body of a newborn child. The skeleton was wrapped in camel fur, as if to keep it from the bitter chill of the north wind. Inside, near the child's head, was a basket containing provisions for the soul. Even after 2,000 years, you could still see grains of wheat, perfectly preserved. The base of the coffin looked like the hull of a boat. We remembered that the coffin of the Lowland princess, excavated by Hedin, had been shaped like a canoe. With a store of wheat, wearing fur boots and camel hair blanket, this child once set out on the long journey to the other world. Now the archaeologists were examining another mummified body. Because the climate is so dry, the body, which was about 155 centimeters tall, or 5 feet, was superbly preserved. Long winding sheets had been wrapped around the body. Dressed in such gorgeous silk, this must be the remains of a noble lady. In those days, it was the custom for men to give their brides feathers of the grey heron as symbols of their marriage vows. Perhaps the feathers in the hair of this mummy had been placed there by her husband, a sign of eternal love. The fate of Lo Lan was inextricably intertwined with the salt waters of the lake on which it stood. In some ways, the rise and fall of Lo Lan seems like the fate of the woman we'd found near the long, dry shore. Lo Lan is again covered by a whirling sandstorm and settles once more into timeless sleep.